السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. الله سبحانه وتعالى in the Quran he says: إن ينصركم الله فلا غالب لكم، وإن يخذلكم فمن ذا الذي ينصركم من بعده، وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, if Allah helps you, then none can defeat you. And if he lets you down, then who else can help you? And in Allah, let the believers put their trust. Over 2 years ago now, we saw the uprising starting, the rebellion starting in Syria. You've already seen a number of videos today showing the progress of how that happened, how the people took to the streets. The response from the regime, the Syrian regime against them, to attack them, even though they were demonstrating only peacefully, in the same way that they had seen in Tunisia, in Libya, in Egypt. We saw the same in Syria, but it took a long time for the world's media to take notice of Syria. The only news we had of Syria in the beginning was what people took on their own cameras and then posted onto the internet, and it was very difficult for them to do that. But we saw the demonstrations growing and growing. And then we saw the regime, the Syrian regime, Bashar al-Assad's thugs, the only word to describe them. We saw that they sent the military against them. They sent missiles, they sent bombs, they sent soldiers. They sent all kinds of horrors against the people of Syria. But then something marked out this revolution amongst all the revolutions, this rebellion. All of the rebellions in the Arab world, they chanted a slogan, Ash'a, Yuri, Isqat al-Nizam. The people, they want the regime to fall, or the system to fall. Yet what we saw in Tunisia, and what we saw in Egypt, was the face of the system changed, but the system stayed exactly the same. And somehow, a lot of the people got fooled, and they were happy with that. And they relaxed, and they stopped protesting when they saw that the face had gone. Even though the system was exactly the same system. The soldiers, the army, the military, the police, they were all there, exactly the same. But yet a face, a ruler himself had changed. What we heard from Syria though, we heard a different slogan. We heard them say, Hiya lillah, hiya lillah. It is for Allah, it is for Allah. This thawra, this revolution. We heard them say something else. We said, they said, Qa'idana lil abad, Sayyidana Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said, our leader for eternity is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They also chanted slogans like, La litadakhal al-ajnabi, the no to the intervention or to the interference of the foreigners. This is what made their revolution different, is that they had a goal in mind, and it wasn't merely isqat the face of the nizam, i.e. the falling of the face of the system. It was the complete change of the system. They didn't only want to get rid of Bashar the butcher. They wanted to completely remove all of the system which put him there. All of the foreign colonial system which kept him there and his father for over 30 years. It was out of fear of this that America desperately saw a difference in the Syrian revolution. And they started to run around looking for somebody to replace Bashar. But they couldn't find anyone. There had been nobody groomed from the opposition who could take his place. There was nobody that could satisfy the demands of the people, which were clearly guided by various ayahs of the Quran, which I'll read in a moment. Nobody could satisfy that. And so every attempt of America was failing, and they couldn't find a person to replace them. So they created something called the Syrian National Coalition. These are Syrian people who don't live in Syria, surprisingly. They were supposed to lead the revolution from outside of Syria. They live in Jordan, they live in Turkey, they live in high-class hotels. You know, the very best five-star hotels. And you're wondering, how do they get paid? Who pays for this, you know, this luxury lifestyle that they're living in? And of course, it's the American embassy. It's the embassies of the West that are paying for them to live in this situation. And they created a military council. They took some of the people who had crossed over, who had left the Free Syrian, left the Syrian army, and created what's called the Free Syrian Army. And then some of those joined with this National Syrian Council to create a National Military Council. So it was like a government in waiting, a leadership for the revolution, but the people did not accept them. These were not people that the Syrian rebels, the people who were in Syria rebelling and being killed and having bombs dropped on their heads. They didn't recognize these people. Firstly, some of them, they didn't know who they were. Secondly, they saw that what they were calling for was something 100% different to what they were calling for. They were risking their lives on the streets of Syria, literally risking their lives and sometimes losing their lives. 100,000 people killed in this conflict up to this point, possibly more. But yet these guys living in these five-star hotels, they were not risking anything. And they were only calling for a complete and exact replacement of what Bashar al-Assad had already given them for the last 30 years, and his father. So we should be suspicious, and Muslims need to be suspicious, of all of these people who stand up and say they speak in the name of the revolution, and they're not part of that revolution, and they're not on the streets with the revolutionaries, and they take their funding from Western embassies, and they're given scripts by Western embassies, and all of their discussions, all of their problems they have are solved by solutions given them by the American and the Western embassies. We should be very suspicious of who they're working for. Are they representatives of the Syrian revolution, or are they representatives of the embassies who are funding them? And if they're not representatives of the embassies who are funding them, then why do they keep funding them? Because you can guarantee that when a person stands up and starts saying, this revolution is for Islam, you don't find any funding going to them. Just as we have not seen any funding from the West going to the Western rebels who are actually risking their lives. So why is it that America is so afraid of these slogans that the Syrian rebels have been chanting? It's because they know it has been motivated by an ayah of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لِيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كَمَا اسْتَخْلَفَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. They know that this is an ayah that the Syrian people have not forgotten and they are motivated by. Because where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Allah has promised those who have believed among you and do righteous good actions, that he will surely grant them succession to authority upon the earth, just as he granted it to those before them. And this is a promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the Syrian rebels have believed in, and they've held on to, and they've clung on to. And this has motivated to even give their lives in this struggle, because they know it is not a struggle which is going to end in vain. They know that this is not giving their lives in a futile struggle. They know that this is giving their lives and risking their lives for something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised them if they believe in Allah and do the good actions. And wallahi, they are doing the good actions. And they know the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is long, but the last part of it says, ثُمَّ تَكُونَ جَبْرِيَّةً فَتَكُونَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ أَن تَكُونَ ثُمَّ يَرْفَعَهَا إِذَا شَاءَ أَن يَرْفَعَهَا ثُمَّ تَكُونَ خِلَافَةً عَلَى مِنْهَجِ نُبُوَّةٍ. And they know this hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he prophesied, how will be the ruling after him for many, many centuries to come. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, afterwards there will be a biting oppression. And definitely this oppression was a very oppressive system of Bashar al-Assad and all of the regimes that we've seen since the end of the last Khilafah. And it will last for as long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. Then he will lift it when he wishes. And there will be a rightly guided, then there will be a rightly guided Khilafah according to the method of the prophethood. So this is the promise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after this oppression, he will offer and he'll give those who deserve it, those who've worked for it, those who've struggled for it, he will give them a Khilafah on the way of the Prophet. So because of this promise, the Syrian people are continuing to struggle. And because of the awareness of this Prophet, this prophecy, and the awareness of this ayah, and the fact that they are bringing it onto their tongues in the streets, and they're continuously repeating this, this is the reason why America is so afraid. So when America and their plans, what they are doing today, and of course Europe and Russia involved in these plans, but mainly led by America today, they are only delaying the inevitable, and they know it. They know this Khilafah is coming back, but they are hoping upon hope that they can delay it for just a few more years, that they can have just a few more years of their colonial corruption before it is all over and they start to see the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come true. So after Bashar al-Assad had already slaughtered over 100,000 people using missiles, sniper attacks, using bombs, using tanks, using arrests and tortures and killing them, hanging them and so on and so forth, of which we've seen over 2 years of these videos on YouTube, and we constantly heard the reports of how horrific the treatment is of the rebels, and not just the rebels, their families and actually neighborhoods, just any people. If you look on the news today, you'll see that the tactic that the Syrian regime adopted today is to fill these, you know, these barrels as big as this podium in front of me, oil drums, fill it with nails and shrapnel and explosives, light a fuse and drop it out of a helicopter into a residential area to kill maximum number of people. And you know, shrapnel doesn't choose just the rebels. It doesn't choose just the so-called terrorists. It kills everybody. It kills the children. It kills the old. It kills the young. It kills everyone. So this is a new tactic that the Syrian regime is using today to create mass hysteria and panic amongst the rebels. Now, the Western countries, America, Britain, all of Europe, Russia, they've seen all of this. And of course, Turkey, Iran, Egypt, the Gulf states, Saudi Arabia, they've seen all of this. They've witnessed all of this for all of this time. Yet they've done nothing. Nothing at all. At one point, a few months back, at one point, when Bashar al-Assad, he decided he was going to use chemical weapons against his own people, and he ended up killing nearly 1,000 people in Ghouta. When he did that, then suddenly, there was an outcry in the West. Suddenly we start hearing about the tyrant Bashar al-Assad and how evil he is for killing his own people. Yet he'd already killed 100,000 people before that, and you didn't notice. And now when he kills using this particular weapon, you suddenly start talking about it. America said they're going to send airstrikes. They're going to punish Bashar al-Assad. And then when it started to get close to the time of actually fulfilling their promise and their threat, they then sent it, you know, Obama sent it to the House of Representatives for another debate in order that they could delay actually acting upon it. And until now, they've not acted upon it. And all it was designed to do was to put pressure on the rebels out of the fear that an American attack might come. You should agree to go to this Geneva conference, the second Geneva conference, which they've arranged for the third week in January coming up. So the whole plan of America is to get the rebels at the negotiating table with the man that has killed them and killed their friends and killed their uncles and their sons and their children and their wives and their mothers and their aunties and killed virtually everybody that Bashar al-Assad could get his hands on. The whole plan of America is to get the rebels to sit down at the table with this man and negotiate the future of Syria. And the plan of America relies upon this Syrian National Council to go to this Geneva conference in the name of the Syrian people to set up a transitional kind of a, you know, a transitional government in order to take over after Bashar is gone. But not asking for Bashar to go before the, you know, even before the conference, to sit down and negotiate with his cronies before they even, you know, before he's even gone and have this discussion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, كَيْفَ وَإِنْ يَظْهُرُوا عَلَيْكُمْ لَا يَرْقُبُوا فِيكُمْ إِلَّا وَلَا ذِمَّةٌ يُرْدُونَكُمْ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَتَأْبَى قُلُوبُهُمْ وَأَكْثَرُهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, how? And he's talking about Fatah Mecca, just after Fatah Mecca, a treaty with the mushrikeen was on the table. He said, how can there be a treaty? Why, if they gain dominance over you, they do not observe concerning you any pact of kinship or covenant of protection. They satisfy you with their mouths, but their hearts refuse compliance, and most of them are definitely disobedient. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about an attitude, and he asked a question, a rhetorical question. How can you expect to have peace with people? If they have the upper hand, they will not make peace with you. Yet when you have the upper hand, you're expected to make peace with them. How can you expect them to honor their agreements? They fear the Western governments today, America and Europe and Russia and the Western world who dominate this international scene at the moment. They fear that the Muslims will establish their rule, a rule that does not involve American dominance or interference, before they are able to put their own people in its place, before they're able to replace their agent Bashar with their new agent, the Syrian National Council. So they are desperately trying to get the Muslims to go to this Geneva conference in order to negotiate the secret, the future. And the future is predicated. There is something that must come before we even see change from the Bashar al-Assad regime. And that is the Geneva II conference is aimed to allow or bring into power this Syrian National Council in the areas which the rebels now hold, which is the majority of Syria. in order to chase and to remove the Syrians, the rebels, the ones who are in power at the moment in the rebel-held areas. So it is in order to take power from them and take away what they have worked for and accuse them of being terrorists, accuse them of working of being extremists or fundamentalists, and take away from everything that they sacrificed for in order that then therefore they can implement an American regime again as they have already had for the last 30 years. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قَدْ بَدَتِ الْبَغْضَاءُ مِنْ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ وَمَا تُخْفِي صُدُورُهُمْ أَكْبَرُ قَدْ بَيَّنَّا لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he exposed this mentality again. He said, hatred has already appeared from their mouths, but what their hearts conceal is far greater. We have certainly made clear to you the signs, if you use your reason. And this is what we're talking about. We're asking people to consider this ayah. This ayah of the Quran revealed by the Creator of the heavens and the earth. Talking about the people who would make peace with such a tyrant. Talking about the people who are willing to continue working with Americans who have supported their arch enemy for all these years. They put him in place, they supported him, they protected him, and they continue to protect him. And they're willing to replace his oppressive rule with another oppressive rule exactly the same. Just it won't have Bashar al-Assad at the top, it will be somebody else. It will just be another man. Kilo maybe. Somebody else who pleases the people. They've suggested a man, Ahmed Duma, because he had an Islamic face. Because this man was considered part of the Islamic opposition in Bashar's time. But he has now agreed to become the head of this Syrian National Council and become the head of this interim government that the Geneva Conference is proposing to put in place. And their only mission is to take over the management of the affairs to rid the world of the Muslims who would stand up for their deen. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ الْعِزَّةَ فَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ جَمِيعًا إِلَيْهِ يَسْعَدُ الْكَلِمُ الطَّيِّبُ وَالْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحِ يَرْفَعُهُ وَالَّذِينَ يَمْكَرُونَ السَّيِّئَاتِ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ شَدِيدٌ وَمَكْرُ أُولَٰئِكَ هُوَ يَبُورٌ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposed it again. He said, whoever desires honor, then to Allah belongs all the honor. To him ascends the good speech. The righteous work raises, and he raises it up. But they who do evil plots, they will have a severe punishment. And the plotting of those, it will perish. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that these people who plot against the Muslim Ummah, who are willing to do deals in back rooms and embassies against the Muslim Ummah to rid the world of those who would call for the establishment of Islam, their evil plots, they will be punished for it on the Day of Judgment. And their plots are coming to an end. Allah has promised that He will defeat their plots for us. So it's absolutely clear. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not allow us to enter into agreements with these enemies, these people who only wish to rid the world of Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا دِينَكُمْ هُزُوًا وَلَعِبًا مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَالْكُفَّارَ أَوْلِيَاءَ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِن كُنتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, O you who believe, take not those who have taken your religion in ridicule and amusement among the ones who are given the scripture before you, nor the disbelievers as allies. And fear Allah if you should truly be believers. Haven't we seen the West mocking Islam? Haven't we seen America constantly telling us our Islam is a joke? Haven't we seen them attacking Islam? They're the ones who play around with Islam and try to throw us in back as and say it's liberal, or you people are too harsh, or you people are barbarians, or your prophet was, and they come up with the most horrendous lies against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are the people who took our deen as a joke, and we want to go back to these people and take them as allies. We want to make deals with America in order that they could dominate us once again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَلَنْ يَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ لِلْكَافِرِينَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ سَبِيلًا And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not permit for the believers to have any way, so for the disbelievers to have any way over the believers. And if we make deals with these people, if we accept them to come to our lands, then are we not, and dominate us, are we not doing exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, expressly said He does not permit? Because the United Nations Security Council, after this chemical weapons attack of Bashar al-Assad, in their resolution number 2118, they all agreed upon one thing, in all this time, They didn't agree that killing the women and children of Syria with bombs is actually something they should do something about, or is something they should even condemn. They couldn't agree, this is all of the international community, they could not agree that sending tanks against unarmed civilians is something wrong and we should condemn it. They couldn't agree to do anything when children are being attacked and bombed with these barrel bombs dropped from helicopters. They can't agree that that is a crime and that they should stop supporting Bashar al-Assad. They still see Bashar al-Assad as the least worst option. He's far better than having Muslims establish a state according to Islam, in their opinion. But when it came to the chemical weapons attack, they agreed upon one thing, and that is that they should go in there and, with their weapons inspectors, remove, with an armed force, the chemical weapons from within Syria. And it's only there because they're afraid that these chemical weapons, any day now, if they're not careful, are about to fall into the hands of the Muslims who will establish a state, which will surely threaten the American colonial interest within the area, perhaps even threaten Israel, which is their main colonial tool within the region. So for that reason alone, to protect their own weapons, which incidentally they themselves gave to the Syrians, to protect their own weapons, they have a resolution. But to protect the people, to honour the people's lives, to talk about the 100,000 plus people who've already been murdered, they couldn't care less. There's no resolution, there's no discussion. This shows us something. It shows us something about the nature of this attack. The nature of this situation we find ourselves today. And this is a global problem we're in today. The problem is that the Americans want to continue colonizing the world. But Islam is the one force in the world that can stand in their way. If the Muslims do wake up and establish their state and are given a khilafah ala minhaj al-nubuwa, the khilafah on the way of the prophethood, then it will not allow for a minute to obey any American orders. It will not allow for a minute to allow America to steal from us the wealth of our lands and produce all of their products at a paltry price. It will not allow for a minute for the Muslims of Syria, of Egypt, of Bangladesh, of Pakistan, of Africa, of Arabia to be enslaved in the workshops creating the cheap garments for the Western markets. It will not allow for a minute for the Western colonialists to continue getting rich at our expense. And this is what they fear the most. They have an irrational hatred of Islam and they wish to see it prevented because it stands in the way of their colonial interests. So because of this reason, they stand against Islam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُسِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاسَةً وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, and fear the trial that will not strike those who have wronged among you exclusively. And know that it is that Allah is severe in penalty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He reminds us that this fitna that the Syrians are suffering today, it's not a fitna that only they are suffering. It is a fitna that the whole world is suffering from. The victims are not only the Syrian people. The victims of this fitna are all the oppressed people on the earth. And the solution or the way forward to bring ourselves out of this fitna, out of this incredible trial that has descended upon us, out of this dhulam and oppression which we find ourselves in. The only salvation for mankind is Islam, and they know it. And that is why they stand opposed to Islam today. And so they're willing to stand opposed to Islam and call all Syrian rebels as if they're terrorists. They're willing to continually talk about if a Syrian rebel makes a mistake, that is the policy of Islam. But if any Westerner makes a mistake, it's not the policy of the West. It's merely an individual who made a mistake. If any Muslim in Britain makes a mistake, that is the policy of Islam. All Muslims should be accused of every crime under the sun. But if a British person makes a mistake, it's just the British person who made a mistake. It's nothing to do with the system. Because their capitalist system isn't to be blamed, but Islam is to be blamed every time. So we find ourselves in this situation. And the first step to solving this problem, the first step to ridding the world of this ugly reality, which is colonialism, and the first step to defeating this Geneva conference is for the Muslims to wake up, particularly the Muslims here in Britain, to wake up and understand the nature of this attack, the nature of this conference. What is it aiming for? It is aiming at further deepening and entrenching American colonialism in our lands. It is not there to save the people. This Geneva Conference will not bring peace to the Syrian people. It will only bring more oppression and more murder and more betrayal of the Muslims. So, it is this that we have to wake up to and understand. And with our tongues we can expose it. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Rasulullah, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُعَذِّبُ الْعَامَ بِعَمَلِ الْخَاسَّةِ حتى يروا المنكر بين ظهرانيهم وهم قادرون على أن ينكروه فلا ينكروه فإذا فعلوا ذلك عذب الله الخاصة والعامة. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, and he's talking about the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with this situation. He said that Allah does not punish the generality, i.e. the general people, all of the people, because of the actions of individuals or groups of them. He does not punish us by the actions of others, except in one situation. And that is when the general, until they see the wrongdoing, the munkar, in their midst, and they're able to forbid it, and they do not forbid it. They're able to speak out against the munkar, which is the Geneva Conference prepared to further enslave the Syrian people, and to spoil the revolution, the blessed revolution, the revolution that aimed to establish Islam. They are able to forbid it, and they don't do it. In that situation, if they do that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish the generality, either all the people and the individuals, the people who are doing the wrongdoing themselves. So we can relate this to those who are about to conspire against the Muslim Ummah. That is the rulers of Turkey, the rulers of Emirates, the rulers of Saudi, the rulers of Egypt, the rulers of all the surrounding countries, including Iran, as well as this Syrian National Coalition, those people who pretend that they want to be the rulers of the next Syria. All of those people, and any Muslim who would support them, whether he is from Britain or from elsewhere, anybody who stands up and does not expose this evil plot, then this is the khasa, this is the individuals that this hadith is talking about. These are the ones who are doing a great munkar, which the Amma, which is us, everybody else, is expected to forbid, expected to speak out against. And if we do not speak out against it, then we can only expect that Allah will punish us along with them. Because we had an opportunity to speak, and we didn't speak. And therefore, we will bear the sin in this life, we'll bear the sin in the next life, and we will suffer the consequence in this life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَاذْكُرُوا إِذْ أَنْتُمْ قَلِيلٌ مُسْتَدْعَفُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ تخافون أن يتخطفهم الناس فآواكم وأيدكم بنصره ورزقكم من الطيبات لعلكم تشكرون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, and remember when you were few and vulnerable in the earth, when you were weak, when you were afraid that people might sweep you away, might kidnap you and take you away. So he gave you homage, he supported you with his victory, and he provided you with good things that you may be grateful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding the Muslims, every Muslim who reads this ayah, he reminds them that this ummah was once so weak that we were even afraid our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was about to be killed at night. So we replaced him with Ali radiallahu anhu, and they escaped. We were so afraid and so weak that at one time our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had to hide in a cave, was only protected by a spider's web from the enemies who wanted to kill him. We were that weak that we were worried that this whole deen would be swept off this entire earth. But alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he protected it. He sent his victory at a time when nobody could believe a victory was around the corner. He subhanahu wa ta'ala provided victory to his Prophet, and they established the state, which grew and grew and grew, and to this day has been the largest empire ever known to mankind. And it has been the most just empire ever known to mankind. And inshallah, it will again be the just empire. Maybe empire is the wrong word. The just khilafah, the just rule, which will dominate inshallah over all other ways and guide the mankind from the darkness into light. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إِن تَنْصُرُوا اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ. He subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you help Allah, then he will help you and he will establish your feet firmly. And the last thing I say is go back to the ayah that I read at the very beginning. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, إِن يَنْصُرْكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ وإن يخذلكم فمن ذا الذي ينصركم من بعده وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون. If Allah helps you, none can defeat you. And if He lets you down, so who is it that can help you? And in Allah, let the believers put their trust. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر لي ولكم والحمد لله رب العالمين.